Well, hello, Love Network family. So excited to be with you again today. This is Pastor Dawn from Dawn Churchill Ministries and Enterprises, and I am excited to bring you Gaining the Master's Edge, where we study mindset mastery on all different levels. And so if you don't know who the master is, he is none other than the most amazing creator, genius, God, heavenly, amazing father of the entire universe. And he is the one who helps us to renew our minds and therefore to walk in the abundance of his love, joy, and peace. So we are in the middle of an episode series on overcoming fear. And so today, I am going to pick up from where we left off last week, but I'm going to share a couple of things before we get started. So if you have your Bibles, I want you to turn to 3 John 2. And this says, he says, "Beloved, I pray that you may prosper in all things and be in health, even as your soul prospers." Now, I think this is one of many scriptures in the Bible that is misunderstood and misaligned or misinterpreted. Because most of the time, we often think that this is just referring to financial prosperity. Now, I'm not saying that it isn't talking about that, because it is. But here's what I want you to wrap your brain around. So John was saying, "Beloved, I pray that above all things that you would prosper and be in health, even as your soul prospers." And so we usually take the first part of that verse and we go, "Yay, I'm going to have financial prosperity and I'm going to have great divine health." Yes, you can, as your soul prospers. So what does that mean? Okay, so that word prosper, I'm so glad you asked. That word prosper means completeness, soundness, peace. It means safety, welfare, health. It also means tranquility, quietness, contentment. It also means the absence of anything that would cause you to be uneasy or not at ease. And since we are talking about destroying fear in our lives, I feel like the definition of this word prosper is very important. So if we are going to prosper in all things and be in health, even as our soul prospers, then that means that our soul has to be prospering so that we can walk in divine health and wealth. So I'm going to give a quote from a very, very famous man, and his name is Les Brown. And he says, "You don't always get what you want from life. You get what or who you are." I'm going to say that again. Les Brown says, "You don't always get what you want or wish for in life. You get who you are or what you are." And in my opinion, that is synonymous with Proverbs chapter 23 and verse 7, which says, "As a man thinks in his heart, so is he." Now, I'm not going to pull that word "think" out of the Strong's Concordance, but what I want you to know is it's not just the thoughts that runs through your brain. As a man thinks, it probably should say, as a man thinks and believes in the core of who he is, in his soul, in his mind, will, and emotions, as he thinks and believes from those core beliefs that have been created since he began breathing life here on earth. So as a man thinks or believes from that place, then so is he. And in my opinion, this coincides with 3 John 2, which says that you will prosper, that you will have divine health and divine wealth, even as your soul prospers. Well, what does it mean to have a prosperous soul? It means, so we've already discussed in previous episodes, that your soul is your mind, your will, and your emotions. It's not your body. It's not your spirit. We are triune beings, just like God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Spirit. We are soul, spirit, and body. So our soul is that part of us, of our mind, will, and emotions. And this is the part of us that we must continually renew because we live in a fallen world. Now, if we lived in the Garden of Eden like Adam and Eve did, there'd be no need for us to renew our minds because in that place, before sin happened, the enemy was not there influencing every single thing of everyday life. Okay, so why did I share this with you? Because I meet a lot of clients who deal with fear, deal with phobias, deal with anxiety issues, deal with chronic fear, doubt, worry, and concern, and they want a magic pill to just make it all go away. But the reality is if your soul is not prospering, if your mind, will, and emotions are not in a constant or at least a semi-constant state of love, joy, peace, security, kindness, etc., then you will not prosper in your health and in your wealth. I'm going to say that again. I did not come on here to talk about money today, but I do want you to know that if your soul is not prosperous, if your mind, will, and emotions are not in a somewhat consistent place of peace, joy, love, gratitude, security, thanksgiving, then you will have issues in your physical health, and it will definitely affect your divine wealth. Well, enough about that today. So what I want to do today is I just want to take you through some scriptures. I told you last week that I was going to give you an example of stress or anxiety or doubt or worry in the workplace. And I'm actually going to get to that at the end of the broadcast. So strap on your seatbelts, go get yourself a cup of coffee or a cup of tea. If you're making a cup for me, make sure that it's chai latte because that's what I like. And I just want you to pull up and enjoy what the Father wants to say to you today. So literally, right before we came on here to record today's episode, so the Lord actually gave me a prophetic word, and so I'm going to share it with you, and I'm going to try to share it slowly because I have a tendency to talk too fast. So the Heavenly Father spoke this to my spirit. He said, there is a very real enemy prowling around, seeking whom he may devour. Satan truly is the epitome of fear and cowardice. From the moment he was cast down from heaven and forced to crawl on his belly, he became fearful of my greatest creation, says the Lord. And what is God's greatest creation? We are. You see, from the beginning of time, before God created the heavens and the earth, it was God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit. And they, although they are three in one, they were, in essence, the first family. And what did God decide? He decided that he wanted children. He decided that he wanted children and offspring so badly that he created the entire universe and a beautiful paradise garden in the Garden of Eden just so that his son and daughter could have a beautiful place to live. So, as the Lord was speaking to me, the Lord said, mankind is made in my image, says the Lord, created in my likeness, given my authority and dominion to rule the earth under my divine kingly leadership, dispensing my goodness, my pleasure, my light, and my glory into every corner of the earth. But Satan's greatest fear is actually man, or we should say mankind, which includes both male and female. If man truly rises up in his and her identity as beloved sons and daughters of the Most High God, made in my image, created in my likeness, possessing my DNA running through their veins, Satan's gig is over. But Satan uses broken people, power-hungry people, abusive people, pride and haughty people, people that he has corrupted through generations of sin and abuse to inflict fear on those who can be devoured, pardon me. Okay, so that's what the Spirit of the Lord spoke to me, really not very long ago. And what I want to share with you is I want to share with you a scripture that speaks to that very thing. And so it is in 1 Peter chapter 5 and verse 8, and it says, "Be sober and be vigilant, because your adversary the devil walks about like a roaring lion, seeking whom he may devour." So if he's seeking whom he may devour, there is the possibility that not everyone is devourable. And I want to suggest to you that if you are a child of God, if you have received Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, if you are beginning to walk out the rest of your life path here on this earth in relationship with God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit, I need you to understand that the devil, Satan, the enemy, the spirit of fear, it does not have the right to devour you. Only you can give it the right to devour you. Now, yes, you may have experienced some things in your past that have created a tendency towards fear, doubt, worry, concern, or even phobias. However, because you are made in God's image and created in His likeness, you have the ability to rewire the faulty wiring that the enemy created in your life through past traumas, past circumstances, past life events. Okay, so what am I saying? I'm saying that Les Brown is right. You do not get what you want in life. You get what or who you are or who you have become. Unfortunately, many of us have experienced things in life that have caused us to open the door to, well, let me rephrase that. We have experienced things in life that those experiences open the door to fear coming in, taking up residence in our mind, will, and emotions, and then creating a tendency toward fear, doubt, worry, concern, and phobias. But God does not desire for us to live in that space. In fact, in Matthew 11:27 through 29, he says in verse 28, "Come unto me, all you who labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest." It is the Lord's desire. There's only one thing that He desires for us to labor in. He does not want us to labor with concerns, with worries. He does not want us to labor wondering how we're going to figure this out or how we're going to make that work. No. He says, "Come to me." He doesn't say, "Come to alcohol," or "Come to shopping," "Come to overeating," or "Come to the NFL game to as a self-soothing mechanism." He doesn't say, "Come to the craps table, you know, to drown your worries in gambling." He says, "Come unto me, all you who labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest." Well, what is rest? Well, rest is shalom. And so I'm going to share another scripture with you, and it is from Isaiah 26 and verse 3. And it says that God will keep him, that him is you and me, can be him or her. So God will keep him or her in perfect peace, whose mind is stayed on God, because that person trusts in the Lord. Okay, so what does that word peace mean? I'm so glad you asked. You guys keep asking all the right questions. I'm so impressed with you. Okay, that word peace is the Hebrew word shalom. And so shalom, again, means completeness, soundness of mind, safety and security, prosperity and health, good welfare, quietness, tranquility, contentment, the very same peace that we spoke about earlier, where it said that your soul to prosper, we talked about your soul prospering and being complete, whole, having soundness of mind. They are one and the same. So God says, if you will come unto me, I will give you rest from all of those things. I will teach you how to walk in your God-given divine identity as a beloved son, a beloved daughter of the Most High God, who is made in the Lord's image, created in His likeness, and predestined for good works and great exploits in the earth. Okay, So I'm going to unpack a little bit of this today for you. And I want to show you how a past moment, we said we were going to talk about fear or worry or doubt in the workplace. And I'm going to give you an example. But before I give you that example, I want to remind you of something that I defined from last week. And I said that your brain and your mind are, while they work in conjunction with one another, they are actually two different things. Your brain is really the electrical computer in your head, but your mind is what holds not just your thoughts and your memories, but whatever emotions are attached to those memories and whatever core beliefs are attached to those memories. Those are all located at or stored in your mind, which can also be considered your psyche. So your mind or your psyche is filled with files, like a memory bank. And you can possibly say that there's thousands and thousands, and I would project that there's probably millions and billions of files in your mind, in your memory, in your psyche. And what they do is they hold all of your memories, good memories and bad memories. Well, we don't remember everything that happened to us in life, but significant memories, let's put it that way. And so whether those significant memories are good or bad, those are lodged into your mind or your psyche. But along with them are attached the emotional responses that you experienced in those significant moments, along with the corresponding core beliefs, the belief system that you decided upon, agreed upon, or resolved within yourself as a result of those moments in time. So it is as if all of these memory files, they're not just the memories. They have all of your concluding beliefs. We're going to talk about that in a few minutes, accompanied by any fear, terror, or intimidation that you may have experienced in those significant moments that then begin to create the habit of worrying that can turn into a lifelong battle with anxiety, fear, phobias, or even delusional disorders. Okay, so let's go to the workplace. I'm just going to give you an example. I would imagine, unless you are just a truly lucky person, that possibly at some point in your life, depending on how old you are, you may have lost a job at some point. And for some of us, losing a job can be a very traumatic moment. And for others, we can be like, oh, thank you, Jesus. I get to go on somewhere else. But here's what I want to propose. Let's take an example. Let's say that it was a job that you loved, and for whatever reason, let's even say that it was for no negligence on your own. Let's say that the company needed to downsize, they had to cut budget, and therefore they had to eliminate some jobs. And they came to you and said, I am so very sorry, but we really enjoy the work that you've done for us, but we cannot keep you. We are going to have to lay you off or let you go. Nobody likes to be fired or let go from a job. Now, depending on what your past is, will depend on how you receive that perceived rejection. So if you have been rejected in the past, it may feel like a huge blow. Not only to your, I don't even want to say your ego, just your sense of security, your sense of safety. Or if you're a fairly confident person, you'd be like, that's okay. I have great skills and I can find a new job, right? So, but what happens if you loved this job? Some of you, depending on your background, you may begin to think in your head. And this is where the enemy comes in. And this is how we can become devourable, in that we don't shut down the fearful, doubtful thoughts that he begins to torment us with. So I'm going to give you two scenarios of how two different people could respond to the same circumstance. So person A, has a little bit of fearful and doubtful tendencies, okay? And we're not going to go into their past and discuss why. But their boss comes to them says the company is downsizing because of financial reasons. They have to let him go. He goes home, and on the way home, the first thing he thinks of is, oh my God, I know he said I did a good job, but I must have done something wrong. There must have been something wrong with the quality of my work production. Oh my gosh, maybe it was so-and-so at the water cooler who told him that this was my fault or whatever. Can you see the illustration that I'm beginning to set up? Or maybe he begins to think, you know, my supervisor has never liked me. He's always been kind of harsh and demanding with me. I bet he decided to choose me just because he doesn't like me. Or I remember that one day when I walked into my supervisor's office and I tried to share with him a minor mistake that he had made in the bookkeeping, and he got really upset with me for showing his mistake. So do you see all of these thoughts that this person is now dealing with? They are allowing, so to speak, their mind to go off on a whole different tangent. So what are they envisioning? They're envisioning that even though the manager said that he was pleased with their work, he began to question whether or not his work was excellent or not. Then he began to question whether his supervisor or boss even liked him as a person or liked him as an employee. Then he began to conjure that maybe someone in the office place had spoken ill of him. Then he began to imagine in his mind that the one time that he had corrected his boss, that his ego had been offended and he'd been holding a grudge against him. Do you see where I'm going? So person A is somewhat wired toward fear, doubt, or anxiety. And so by the time person A gets home, he is in a fearful mess. And not only is he in a fearful mess, but he's also condemning himself. You know, I should have done this better. I should have done that right. I shouldn't have corrected my boss that one day. I should have just let him find the accident, and then he wouldn't be mad at me for revealing it to him, and so on and so on and so on. And then what happens? All of this fear, all of this worry, all of this doubt, all of this conjecture, which I can tell you right now come from one place, the pits of hell. Really, the enemy is just toying with his mind. And then what happens? He goes, oh my God, I have to find a new job. What am I going to do for money? This was my only job. I don't have a 401k yet. I don't have a big savings plan. And so he begins to walk in fear of lack, scarcity in his finances. That can then blossom into, what if I can't find a new job right away? What if I can't find a job that pays me the same amount? What if I dislike that job even more than I dislike this job? And on and on and on we go. Have any of you ever been there? I can admit, in many years past, I was there more often than I would like to admit. And it took me following God's strategies that he began to give me of rewiring my mindset and renewing my mind with the word of God. So what is going to happen with person A? Well, if they're not able, I shouldn't say they're not able, if they don't choose to, if they don't believe that it is within their power to control their thoughts, to cast down imaginations that are set up against the knowledge of God, to walk in the mind of Christ, if they don't come unto God, but the Bible says, we just talked about it, come unto me, all you who labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. If that person doesn't enter into the presence of God and hear what God has to say about it, then they will likely continue to stew in this negative cycle of fear and doubt and worry and rejection and condemnation, etc., etc. Okay. And so then what happens? Then they begin to look for a new job, but they still haven't resolved the fear and the anxiety that they experienced from the previous job they just were let go from. So now every single job interview that they walk into, they walk in with fear, doubt, and anxiety. Now, the world, when I say the world, I mean the world that is apart from the kingdom of God, that is apart from believing that Jesus Christ is the Messiah apart from believing in God. They have kind of caught on to this. And you will see all kinds of now ungodly forms of mindset mastery, of renewing your mind, that have absolutely nothing to do with the Word of God. And what they generally do is they focus on you getting what you want, when you want it, how you want it. And I'm not saying that God isn't a generous God, because He definitely is. But God wants us to receive lavishly from Him as He pours into our lives. And we can receive gargantuanly more blessings from the Lord than we can from securing them for ourselves outside of Him. Okay. So again, so what the world would say was, well, if you're vibrating fear, then fear is what you're going to get. And yes, in essence, that is correct. However, it's not that simple. The problem is our identity. See, person A forgot that he's a child of the Most High God. Person A didn't go to God and say, Lord, this door has closed. Is there a new door that you're opening for me? Person A did not cast his cares upon the Lord and ask the Lord to fill his heart up with his love, joy, peace, and strength. Person A just started stewing in all of these negative thoughts that began to spiral him downward. And I can almost guarantee you, in the immediate future and in the extended future, that person will walk into job interviews, and even the ones that they are offered new jobs, they will likely continue to struggle with fear and anxiety in the workplace because they have not resolved the trauma, the fear that came from the trauma of losing that particular job. Okay, now I'm going to give you person B, all right? Same person. Let's say that it's a woman, and she's called into the office by her supervisor. Supervisor tells her the same thing. I'm sorry, ma'am. We are downsizing. We're struggling financially as a company. You've done an excellent job for us, but we have to let you go. And of course, you know, she doesn't really like it, but she says, okay. And she gets in the car. And the very first thing that she does is, well, if she's like any woman like myself, she might cry a little bit because it was disappointing. But she says, okay, Father God, what is your perspective on this? And as she begins to lift her hands in worship, as she connects to the vine, in John 15, it says that He is the vine and we are the branches. If we remain in Him and He remains in us, then we will produce much fruit. But we cannot do anything apart from the vine. And so she says, Heavenly Father, you are my Father. You are my Jehovah Jireh. I know that this job is only one aspect, is only one stream of revenue or income that you have for me. And I know that according to your will, that you will take care of me. So Father God, how do you want me to respond to this job loss? And the Father begins to speak to his daughter. And he reaffirms to her how much he loves her. He might even tell her a couple of things. I know in one situation, I lost a job and I was very upset. And the Lord said, Dawn, why are you tripping? He says, it was time for you to go. He goes, do you remember 3 months ago, I told you I wanted you to look for a different job, but you didn't listen because you were afraid. And I was like, oh yeah. Regardless of what the father says to his daughter, he begins to fill her heart up with all of his goodness. And he says, I am your provider. There's no need for you to have worry, fret, or doubt. If I take care of the lilies of the field, if I feed the sparrows of the air, will I not take a good care of you? He says, I am a good, good father. And I know that even though you are made in my image and created in my likeness, I also know that there's a frail humanity part of you that is but dust. And I have great compassion for that. And so he begins to speak to her, and I'm just going to give you a scenario that could happen. And he says, you know what? Your supervisor said that you did a great job. I want you to call him on the phone or email him and ask him for a glowing recommendation for your next job. Now, the reality is that supervisor really did think she had done a great job. And so when she calls and says, you know what, would you mind writing me a letter of recommendation? She is surprised. Oh, and before she even asks, she goes to the Father and she says, Father, I thank you for your grace. I thank you for your favor upon my life. I thank you that because your favor rests upon me, because I am your daughter, I thank you that he will give me a glowing recommendation, because he did say he was very pleased with my work. She calls her supervisor and he says, by all means. And he gives her an amazing, glowing letter of recommendation. And she begins to put feelers out for a new job. She asks God to lead and guide her by his Spirit and to show her the three, you know, the different aspects or the different doors that she might walk through. And within 2 weeks, she has three job offers. And at least two of them pay significantly more than the job that she was just let go from. But because of her work history, because of her resume, and because of the glowing recommendation that she received, her new employer felt very confident that they were going to be hiring someone who walked in excellence. Now, I realize that these are imaginary illustrations, but the truth of the matter is, I've been in both situations. I've been person A and I've been person B. And when I've been person B, it's because I took enough time to sit before the Lord and allow him to begin to renew my mind. Now, am I saying that that was a completely easy thing? No, not always. What happens is, as we discussed last week, there are traumatic moments that open the door for fear, doubt, worry, anxiety to walk in and then at least torment us for a season. Or if we don't know how to resist it, if we don't know how to rebuke it, if we don't know how to cast down those evil thoughts and imaginations, then that spirit of fear begins to set up camp. And it kind of and comes in and visits us at our front door or maybe in our living room, and it just kind of keeps coming back. And because we don't know our authority in Christ, we don't know how to cast that down, we don't know how to renew our mind with the Word of God, then what happens is we just become more and more and more devourable, and that is definitely not God's will for us. Now, I said that I was going to not only give you an example from the workplace, but here's what I want you to see. In most cases, when we have a circumstance like a job loss that feels very traumatic to us, in most cases, that traumatic moment feels like something that has happened in our past that felt the same. And this is how the enemy keeps us in cycles of fear. So I'm not going into a long explanation, but let's say I gave you person A and he was a man. Let's say that when person A was 6 years old, I don't know, a lot of his classmates at school made fun of him with criticism and rejection. And that caused his little heart to be anxious. And he would go to school the next day and he began to worry whether or not his classmates were going to pick on him and make fun of him. And from year to year to year, that anxiety, that doubt, that fear, that worry just began to grow more and more and more. And so what happened is he started to expect being made fun of. He started to expect being rejected. He started to expect not being invited to the basketball game. He started to expect not being chosen on the basketball team or what have you. And that little boy grew up into a man who struggles with fear, doubt, and insecurity, and he carries it with him everywhere he goes. Now, the world will say that if you are vibrating fear, that more fear is going to be attracted to you. And I agree with that to an extent, but that is not the end of the story. So the law of attraction, in my estimation, is really a spiritual thing. Ephesians 3:20 says, now unto him, this is talking about God, who is able to do exceedingly abundantly above all we could ever ask, think, or imagine, according to the power of God that works in us, to him be all praise, glory, and honor. You see, there is a magnetic force within your spirit that draws the goodness, grace, favor, provision, and abundance and blessing that God has already provided for you. When you position yourself properly, you will magnetize good things from heaven as every good and perfect gift comes down from the Father of lights. Because you are a child of God, you are already connected to the Maker of all things. But you must be directed by the Spirit of God within you. You must allow your faith, words, thoughts, and every other area of your life to be directed by the Holy Spirit. Before we close today, I said that when you position yourself properly, so how do you position yourself properly to not walk in fear, but to walk in faith, to not walk in cowardice, but to walk in the Bible says that the righteous are as bold as a lion. Now, the Bible doesn't say that we are as harsh as a lion. So God is represented both in the lion and the lamb. We are as bold as a lion, but we have the compassion and grace of a lamb. But he says that the righteous are as bold as a lion, that he has not given us a spirit of fear, timidity, or cowardice, but he has given us a spirit of power and of love and of a sound mind. And so today I want to leave you with the resolution that it is entirely possible for you to walk in faith, in power, in love, and a sound mind, free of the torment of fear, doubt, worry, and concern. Now, I know I've unpacked some of it, but not all of it. Rewiring your mindset, becoming a master at mindset development is almost like studying a new course, and it does take some time to master the skills. I actually have a mastermind class that is called Annihilating the Spirit of Fear, and I would love to invite you to join me. You can reach me at dawnchurchillministries@gmail.com. You can visit my website, dawnchurchill.org, or you can go to my institute site, which is dawnchurchillinstitute.teachable.com. And of course, you can follow me every single week here on loveradionetwork.com. Now, next week, I'm going to give you some more examples, and I'm going to give you some more tips and tricks of the trade that will help you to defeat fear and truly be able to rise up with faith and power and love and a sound mind. And so as we close today, I'm just going to speak a quick prayer of faith and blessing over you. Father God, in the name of Jesus, I thank you that you dearly love all of your sons and daughters, and you desire for us to rise up in our true identity as beloved children of the Most High God, who have authority and dominion over every work of the enemy. Every work of the enemy includes fear. It includes doubt, and it includes unbelief. And you have given us your spirit as that thing that works within us, that quickens us to remind us of who we are in Christ. So in the name of Jesus, Father God, I pray an open window blessing to fall upon each one of them, infusing their faith, bringing peace and tranquility and security to their heart, and causing their spirit to be strengthened in their innermost being through your power, your love, your light, and your glory. Father God, in the name of Jesus, I thank you very much that you love them enough, that you allowed them to hear this podcast episode, and that you intend for them to walk in faith and not fear. Well, again, don't forget, please join me every single week on loveradionetwork.com. We are on Tuesday nights at 6 p.m. Central and 7 p.m. Eastern. And I will be your host, Pastor Dawn Churchill, as we gain the Master's Edge. Until next time.